Jon Howell, the CEO of HEMSI, joins me now. HEMSI, you know, it's an acronym. I think it's always helpful to remind people it's Huntsville Emergency Medical Services, Inc. And Jon, your team, you guys are really on the point of this in a way that I think it's helpful to underline to make people, you know, let people hear it again. You have crews that go out in the worst situations that people find themselves, helping people out in car wrecks and things like that. How have you had to adjust, or how have they adjusted to these sort of situations with COVID-19 as the backdrop?
Well, Greg, our crews are doing an amazing job. All the way from our 911 center communication staff to the people in the ambulances. And this is a stressful time for them. They're very worried. They don't want to become exposed, and they don't want to carry COVID or the coronavirus out from their area, but they want to care for their community. So they have that sense of duty, and luckily during this time when our community has slowed down a little bit and practicing some distancing, our call volume has gone down some, and that's created a little bit less of a stressful environment just from a call volume perspective for us. So we're probably only going maybe 140, 150 responses a day now. That had been up to close to 200 before all this hit. We've left our full schedule in place. We've got actually some extra unit schedule. We're trying to keep as many units on the road as we can, trying to divide the work up into as many hands to make it lighter. But the calls where we do have to go and dress out in our personal protective equipment or our PPE, they take a little bit longer, and they're obviously a little bit more stressful for our staff to deal with.
And let me bear down on that just for a second. So you guys, and this would be good news, you're not at the point where you're stretched like we hear nursing staffs across the country where they're absolutely exhausted. So you guys aren't at that point yet because of the low calls compared to what it was.
That's correct. We aren't.
That's a good thing.
That is a good thing. We aren't over stretched ourselves. We haven't seen a lot of significant fatigue in our crews, and you know, our crews, they would probably tell you that this is a little bit of a lighter workload than they were used to before all this hit. But we are trying to keep our capacity high. We're trying to keep our responsive, our readiness ready to respond in case we start to get a surge. And we're trying to keep all of our folks on the road who can get on the road.
And let's talk about the gear. Do you have what you need? I mean, are you in a good shape there? And if this thing goes another month, do you think you'll be in good shape?
We've got enough of our gear for probably this week. We've got more coming in. If we get our shipments in, I think we'll be okay. I've learned that you never have enough.
Right.
You know, right now I'm spending a lot of my day planning out where our equipment is going to be, where we're going to be in a week or 2 weeks from now. So we're constantly every day evaluating what was our burn rate on our gear yesterday? How much did we go through? How much do we have left? When's our next shipment coming in? If that doesn't come in, where can we go and get that other piece of equipment filled?
And there's one other question I want to get to. So, are you competing for gear the way you see governors get on the cable news networks and say, I'm having to compete with so many people? Are you in a situation like that, that you're having to compete with so many people to get gear?
I think the only people we're competing with is when we call our vendors who normally supply us, and they're telling us, well, that's on back order. And we're saying, well, we want you to put us at the first of the line.
Right.
But for the other public service agencies here in Madison County and North Alabama, no, I don't feel like we're competing. In fact, if Chief McMurray or Chief McFarland were to call me from the fire department and we need some extra face shields, we would accommodate that, and I think they would accommodate us in the same way.
Finally, last question, and these conversations we've had with a lot of important people in the community, and you certainly are one. What do you need people to know right now? What do you need people to hear that they need to do from your time here moving forward? What do they need to know?
Well, they need to know that if they have to call 911, that we're going to ask some questions We're going to ask some questions about, does the patient have a fever? Do they have any type of flu-like symptoms? And we want people to answer those questions honestly. And if they don't know, tell us you don't know. If you don't know if they have a fever, just say, I don't know. We also want you to know that when our personnel arrive on scene, they may stop and they may want to put on a gown or they may want to put on a face shield. And don't be offended by that. They're doing that to try to protect themselves and try to protect our community. And we go into a lot of situations where we don't know what the status is of the patient. So we're going to take the precautions. So please don't be offended by that. But know that, if you need us, we're going to be there. We don't need folks to call us for unnecessary items. We don't need people to call 911 just to get information. We've got other resources like 211 potentially for that. But if you do need us, we'll be there. We may have to take a few extra steps to get ready to treat you, but we will take care of you and we will get you to the hospital.
That's great advice. Be the person that thanks them for showing up. Absolutely. The times I've needed you guys, man, they're so fast and incredible. Thank you, John. Glad you're here. Thanks for being here.